Hello, Ben, and welcome to the Center for the Less Good Idea. Hi, William and Phala. Nice to see you. You're at the Center for the Less Good Idea. What is the Center for the Less Good Idea?
The Center for the Less Good Idea is a center in which artists, theatre makers, filmmakers, composers, choreographers, dancers are invited to come together and work out the energy that comes from working across disciplines and also from working where an outcome is not necessarily known in advance, where you're open to the less good ideas emerging from the edges of a project and taking center space. It's a privileging the periphery.
Can you say more about how that works in practice?
The idea at the center is to really get away from, you know, the headspace in terms of the theory of things, you know, and work through material, putting things on the floor and making sure that, you know, the work and the way of doing tells you what to do, as opposed to philosophizing about it and over-analyzing, you know, ideas. Because in that way, you know, when you have a good idea, sometimes if it stays there, you're forcing something that, you know, cannot happen or that collapses and is too...
The name of the Center for the Less Good Idea, comes from a Tswana proverb, which says that if the good doctor can't cure you, find the less good doctor. You need ideas that come from the edge. It's also about saying Johannesburg is not the center of an art world, but the periphery and things that can come from the periphery can really change and alter what is thought of in the center.
And the thing that is important to also know about the center is that, I mean, this is also based on collective, you know, practice, where collaboration is key, you know, in doing that. And also understanding that, you know, the collective has much more, you know, contribution and voices when people come together and energize the space as opposed to just the individual.
This idea of play and exploring ideas on the periphery of the original idea, it seems to me, is crucial in terms of that limiting that ability that you can have as a creator to be too fastidiously focused on a kind of self-conscious idea of what the outcome should be. Can you say more about that?
Yeah, I mean, the thing about, you know, work is that the moment you put, you know, and you hang on to a grand idea about the work, that becomes an obstacle in you know, trying to make the work itself. So whenever you get into work with an open mind of, you know, what the work can be, and also with an acknowledgement that because you are working with other people, they also have ideas, and that your ego must, you know, be on the side, and that the work must, you know, take, you know, the center space, then that becomes, you know, a fruitful way of working. You know, is the healing, is the process of healing, is the process of unwinding and vulnerability, you know. So there are so many elements, you know, that come into play when one puts work, you know, and works through, you know, material in the space.
I mean, for all of us who were locked down and have been and still in different stages locked down over the year, the relief when we gathered at different times to start working again, saying, oh, we're not just alone in a house. Mm. There's other musicians, the kind of the, for all of us who are doing it. I mean, I certainly felt it for myself, and I'm sure for other, other true, practitioners, true. To be allowed to practice. I mean, one of the hardest things for, you know, as a visual artist, it's been relatively easy. I have my studio, I can go and make my drawings and that. But for all our colleagues who are musicians, dancers, actors, who've not even been able to practice their métier this last year, has been calamitous, has been very, very, very hard, both financially but also psychically.
Yeah. Can you say something about who the people are that take part in the programme? Who are these practitioners that you're talking about?
We've worked with a number of, you know, artists from, you know, South Africa, and we do have a few international, you know, people. But basically, the community of artists is, every artist is welcome at the center. And the way in which we work is that, you know, at the beginning, when you have a curator who invites, you know, a person that they want to work with, and then that person invites another person that they would like to work with. And now we have got a community of over, you know, close to 600 people. Basically, we embrace, you know, a little bit of nepotism, you know, a little bit of favoritism, you know, has gotten us to where we are, because, you know, it's about the network of people that you know, and sometimes it's somebody who you want to work with that you invite in, you know, and that has been the basic way of connecting and building a community. But largely our people come from, you know, Johannesburg, you know.
I mean, it's also the range. They're from people who are very senior actors, so they're both there as actors, so there's very strong mentors as teachers for people who are just out of theatre school, for mid-career actors. The same with musicians. We have Kyle Shepherd, a top jazz pianist in the world, who's done concerts here and then improvised with other musicians. We've got musicians who've never played before who come together, like Mika and Volley, and suddenly are an extraordinary duo that continues and has an extraordinary presence. So it's a range. I mean, it has the demographics of South Africa. The way it works, the principle is that the curators change each season, and they can invite the performers they want to do in it.
Does it have a sort of structured community outreach or educational program? In other words, are you extending into the community around the centre, or how much is a sort of self-selecting element?
No, we're saying that the community of artists, of which there are many, many thousands, is the central community of it. If you look over the years, there have been many, many different community, but its focus is not saying that is its direction. Its direction are the thousands of artists, and that is the that is our central community.
You know, in our sixth season, we had a very big procession with, you know, Congolese funeral dancers and a Congolese, you know, brass band. We had Pantsula dancers. We had Dinaka dancers, which is, a Sepedi kind of an art form. So we invaded, you know, the city in a way, you know, parts of, you know, the areas around here. You know, for us, it has to be organic, natural, and it has to be, you know, led by the artist wanting to do something, as opposed to being enforced as a requirement.
Right. And you talked about healing earlier on, and it seems to me that one of the crucial things that I think will emerge from these discussions that we're having today is the act of making is a healing act to a certain degree.
It is. I think there's a sense of agency of going from silence into your voice, of not making a sound to being singing. There's a sense of possibility in the world. When you start with an empty stage and two people confront each other and an action, a conflict, something starts to happen, there's a sense of being alive in your body, in the focus you have to have. And it's both a demonstration of what agency is, and it's an example of it. So it's both a metaphor and a physical, practical example.
You've talked already, William, about the demands and the, you know, terrific hardships actually experienced by performers over the last year. What has the centre been able to do in the last year through lockdowns and through this crisis?
We had one project, a radical rethinking of Waiting for Godot, which had to do with re-examining the political connectedness of Samuel Beckett.
Come back tomorrow.
And the day after tomorrow.
Possibly.
But we also had projects which were possible to do long distance. So we had a series of one-minute films that people made either on their cell phones, or other. We had over 100 different films that were made and showed on our website and on our Instagram account. Then there was a project also saying, how can we do something that's not just digital, but that involves social distancing? And this is a series of billboard, which are collaborations between poets and artists making signs which are on 18 meter long billboards over the highway.
One of the projects that, you know, we did was what we called a considered 3 minutes, which was basically, you know, it was part of the elongation of some of the long minutes project that we liked and thought that, you know, they needed a little bit more, you know, of space, you know, to tell the story. And then the outputs of Portraits of Johannesburg is basically performances that will be happening in some spaces, found spaces around, you know, the city.
And it'll be shown
on Instagram and on YouTube and on our Facebook.
Just to return to the Highway Notice project, there was one, it seemed to me, that was terrifically emblematic, and it was one of your blue rubrics, William, which said simply, breathe.
The three breaths that were in the air last year. The one was when the piece was done, it was just after when Black Lives Matter started growing in the United States. And then, of course, in the pandemic, it's all the people who are dying from drowning in their lungs where they cannot breathe. But it also has to do, as you say, with the whole ecosystem being able to breathe, to understand breath as an active and necessary part of living. So it was able to take all the different associations of the moment.
But I mean, it speaks to a kind of need for a kind of intersectional thinking, right?
You know, with the center, at least we know and understand that we have freed ourselves from the responsibility of thinking that, you know, art should, you know, always be about other and not ourselves. You know, so art here is made by the artist for the artist, you know, for other people. But, you know, the central thing is building that community and making sure that we do not switch off the light of, you know, people who want to do work and are not doing work because they are funded by somebody who wants to tick, you know, certain kind of, you know, boxes. You know, the first billboard of, you know, Williams of saying breathe is that also the art needs to breathe. It needs spaces where it is not, you know, normally occupying and that. So it was quite a nice metaphor about, you know, giving it a new breath as well. Mm. I mean, the thing that I like to say, you know, Ben, is that we have allowed science to advance itself on failure and elimination of failure. That's what we call experiment. That's what labs are for, you know. And then we on the other hand expect art to be perfect and not to advance itself on the very same kind of elements, you know, of failure and eliminating failure. And the Center for the Less Good Idea is a typical example of, you know, a lab where we are looking at, you know, different ways of, you know, the art advancing itself, or, you know, and based on a simple, you know, principle of a less good idea. You know, so the science is always looking for eliminating, you know, ideas until they find the right kind of a thing. Right now we're talking about, you know, the COVID, you know, vaccine. There's some COVID vaccine here in South Africa which has arrived and it's not working because the disease itself has advanced. You know, and then now they found, oh, this one can respond. And that's basically, you know, the failures and the successes of you know, science. And even in the art, in the same, we will always get, you know, things that work and sometimes things that don't work, and it is fine.
Now, we're terrifically privileged today because you're actually going to give us access to a new work made by the Centre. So can you tell us a bit about it?
The work is called Uhambo Imizwa Nomsindo, which, you know, literally translates, you know, the journey, feelings and noise. You know, umsindo could mean sound, you know, can also mean noise. So it is led by Sibusiso Shozi. It, you know, it has Mika Manganye, Volin Chabeleng, it has Dikele Dumudubu, and Freedom Muswani, and who else? Musa Mboweni. Yes. So I hope that I've actually, you know, included everybody. So it's an exploration of the gift of song and spirituality and the gift of story in you know, through song. Basically, it's a song that has been sung generation to generation from, you know, his family, you know, and he had, you know, a single phrase of the song that he then, you know, began to develop with others, with the input of others, what it means for them.
Thank you.
William and Phala, that was just such an amazing performance, so thank you for sharing it with us, and goodbye. Thank you so much for this extraordinary experience.
Thank you for being with us, Ben. Till next time.